speakers. So the first speaker that that we have today is Maria Antonietta Tosches. She's an assistant professor at Columbia University in New York, and she just started her lab 1 year ago, and she works on species of amphibians that are called Spanish net. And she's a fellow Italian, but then he did her PhD at Heidelberg, and now she's in the US. So please, Maria Antonietta, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Alberto, and thank you everyone for organizing this exciting conference. It's like the future of conferences. So in this talk, I will just take you through our recent work and mostly through my postdoctoral work as a in the lab of Gilles Laurent in Frankfurt, to explain what motivates us to study reptiles and more recently amphibians. These are species that you will not normally see in a neuroscience lab or not so frequently. And the deep motivation is that it's coming from the history of neuroscience itself. Neuroscience started as a comparative discipline. If you look at the work of Cajal, for example, he has been using, is switching between different species, even between vertebrates and invertebrates, to compare and to try to infer general principles of brain organization. In this example, it's a comparison between the retina of flies and vertebrates. And later on, major discoveries in neuroscience came from exploiting the animal diversity in species, so exploiting species that are not so much studied anymore nowadays. And the work I'm going to talk about today, it was done on two reptilian species, an Australian dragon, Pogona viticeps, and an American turtle, the red-eared slider. And now in New York, my lab is starting new work on the Spanish ribbed newt, which is an amphibian. Just to remind everybody where we are in the phylogenetic tree, reptiles and birds are together sauropsids, and they split from the ancestors of mammals 300 million years ago, 320 million years ago, so a very long time ago. And the last common ancestor of amniotes and tetrapods was an animal that lived shortly before, so 350 million years ago. We're looking at deep phylogenetic splits, but nevertheless, we know that the overall organization of the brain in all vertebrates, it's conserved, because we can identify a telencephalon very confidently in all vertebrate species. And we can also identify a dorsal compartment of the telencephalon, which is also called pallium. And you see this highlighted in orange in these brain sections. And the pallium is the part of the brain that also includes the cerebral cortex. The cerebral cortex is defined as a layered structure, and it exists as a layered structure only in reptiles and mammals. And in mammals, it goes from the most medial part of the pallium, which is the traditionally called archicortex, the hippocampus, to more lateral regions where you find the olfactory cortex, the piriform. And in reptiles, it retains a simpler organization. So you don't find the fully elaborated six-layered cortex that exists in mammals, but there is a more rudimental three-layered organization. In amphibians, the dorsal telencephalon or pallium is not defined as a cortex because it does not have a properly layered organization. But nevertheless, the regionalization of this part of the brain into medial, dorsal, and lateral compartments is conserved. So if we zoom in, you will see what I'm talking about when I refer to layers. So this is the traditional six-layered mammalian neocortex. The reptilian cortex that consists indeed of one layer of cell bodies, these are the principal neurons or pyramidal neurons, and two layers of that are mostly populated by axons and dendrites, and the reptilian pallium, where you don't find, essentially you don't find a layer three, the layer three that you would find in a reptile. So we and others over the years, we've been asking, is there anything in common between these parts of the brain besides the common developmental origin? And with people have looked, for example, at diversity of morphologies of pyramidal neurons, and there is indeed there are indeed important novelties on the mammalian side, which I will not have time to discuss. But besides these morphological descriptions, it was really limited molecular work. So what we've done in the past 5 years is to take this problem and to focus on comparisons of cell types across species and transform this problem from an anatomical and morphological problem to a genomics problem. So we've collected single cell data sets from turtles, lizards, and more recently also from the Spanish newt. And we're setting up methods to compare these data sets across species in order to make cell type comparisons over these large evolutionary distances. And just to outline our workflow, what we're doing is to dissect out our brain regions of interest, capture single cells with microfluidics device, obtain single cell sequencing data where we have gene expression data for each individual cell that we've captured. We cluster cells to identify cell types that are operationally defined in our case as clusters in the single cell data set. And then we take these clusters and we do two things. And this is what the most time consuming aspect of our work. We do spatial mapping. So we identify cluster specific genes and we look at their expression in the tissue in order to connect anatomy and gene expression. And we do cross species comparisons using data integration algorithms that take into account the entire transcriptomic data set that we're handling. And by doing this, we came to two broad conclusions that I want to share with you today. The first is that with this cell type resolution, you can identify ancient cell types, even in tissue architectures that would be otherwise very diverging. And one case is the case of GABAergic interneurons. There we found the GABAergic interneurons in reptiles. And when we integrate this data with mammalian data, we can see that the neuron types from these two species align together, indicating that broad classes of GABAergic neurons are evolutionarily conserved. Another case is the case of hippocampal cells. So in this plot, you see the mapping of lizard cells, glutamatergic cells on mouse clusters. And you see that there is significant mapping of clusters between the reptilian hippocampus, which is in rows, and the mammalian hippocampus, which is in columns. And we have confirmed using more traditional approaches that marker genes that demarcate the different hippocampal subdivisions of mammals are also expressed with the similar patterns in the reptilian hippocampus, even though the reptilian hippocampus is not folded on itself, but as is stretched out. So we have identified the integers C1 and C3. And with a similar approach, we've also discovered that there are cell types in the reptilian pallium that map, because of their high transcriptomic similarity, to cells in the mammalian claustrum. The claustrum is this brain region deep into the telencephalon, which had a very mysterious anatomy and function. And using the single cell approach, we have identified this claustrum homolog in reptiles, and we have and this has led to further analysis of connectivity and function that you can read more into our recent publication. Okay, so this is about ancient conserved cell types. And the second broad conclusion is that the mammalian pyramidal neurons that make up the six-layered cortex are instead evolutionary novelties. So it's not all conserved, but there is a mixture of conserved cell types and new cell types. And this is more evident when you look at this plot. It's a complex plot, but it's essentially showing you gene expression of very well characterized mammalian layer markers, which are the markers that define the cell types in the mammalian cortex. And this is on the left side. And on the right side, you see the same markers in the turtle dorsal cortex cell types. And you can see that these mammalian markers are not identifying any cell type in turtles, but they tend to be either co-expressed everywhere or not expressed at all. So we cannot, with these transcriptomics data, unlike the case of GABAergic neurons, we cannot define glutamatergic pyramidal neurons in turtles that are homologous to individual layers of the mammalian neocortex. But what we can do is still to find broad similarities at the level of upper layers and deep layers. What they're looking here is a correlation score between the different turtle and mouse cell types. And you see that there are these two correlation blocks that define upper layer-like cells and deep layer-like cells in the turtle. And the surprise was that these upper layer-like cells and deep layer-like cells are arranged into sublayers themselves within this layer two of the reptilian three-layered cortex. So indicating that there's a hidden layered organization in these reptilian cortices. And this disorder is actually matching the birth order of the cells because the deep layer-like cells of the turtle are the early born neurons of the turtle cortex. And they end up being in a superficial part of layer two because at the transition to mammals, there's been an inversion of the corticogenesis gradient as represented in this diagram. So to summarize, by studying cell types in this unusual species, we have discovered that GABAergic types, at least the broad classes, are evolutionarily conserved, and that glutamatergic neurons in the mammalian neocortex have probably evolved through a process of diversification, where the gene regulatory programs in the ancestors of mammals and reptiles have been highly elaborated in the mammalian lineage to produce new cellular phenotypes. And this work shows that with the new genomics technologies, high-resolution cell type atlases can be generated from new animals, and this opens up new avenues for further investigation. That mammalian cortical circuits are evolutionary mosaics of ancient and new cell types, and that other ancient, deeply conserved neuron types are hidden in brain areas that otherwise have very different neuroanatomy, different morphologies. And that's the case for the hippocampus and claustrum. So what's next? My lab is exploiting the simplicity and the genetic tractability of Spanish newts to focus on two points. One is the mechanism of neuronal diversification, and the other is looking at principles of neuronal coevolution to understand whether there is any deeply conserved circuit motif that is made up of these conserved cell types. And with this, I want to thank my postdoc lab, my current lab, and thank you for your attention.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Maria Antonietta, for the wonderful talk. And yeah, for sure, reptiles and amphibians are not the the primary choice for most of neuroscientists. So it's interesting to also to look at ancestors of mammalians and other other species that are more used in neuroscience. So if the attendees have questions, please use the Q&A button to ask the speaker. So in the meantime, I have one question myself. So you have studied the neurons, let's say, from a genetic point of view. Have you also looked, or do you know if there are some, let's say, other shared properties that, for example, the cortical GABAergic neurons share among different species? So morphology or some electrical behavior?
That's one of the questions we're interested in exploring now, because we think that if you think that the molecular conservation of these cells may indicate the conservation of circuit motifs, it's of course a speculation that we need to verify experimentally, but there are some good indications in, you know, that support that idea. First is the fact that when you look deeply at what are the genes that have similar expression, you find neurotransmitter receptors and that indicated, for example, some of these neurons may be may have a conserved function in integrating or relaying brain state information in cortical networks. So that's one thing that we are interested in understanding further. And also another interesting point is that these cells, these GABAergic cells, are not distributed randomly in these cortices or tissues, but they have a they're distributing in depth in a way that is resembling their mammalian counterparts. For example, in the turtle, we find that the neural glia form cells, homologs, are also enriched in layer one. So they're also in the subpial position, very similar to the neural glia form cells in mammals. So that's another thing that would be interesting to explore.
Thank you very much. I see that there are three great questions, but...